How you guys doing? There it is. Great to see you this morning. Great to see you. Well, I want to start off by saying, who here likes good news? Raise of hand. A lot of you. I love good news. I love it so much. And maybe you love it so much too. We always share it, right? Whenever we get good news, we go out and we share that good news. What, no matter what it is. I mean, it could be anything from getting married, right? You post it on Facebook, beautiful wedding pictures. It could be a promotion. You share that with your friends and your family. They're like, this is good. Look at what happened at work. It's amazing. Kids graduating, 'tis the season. Today, HCA graduation is happening. That's some good news. Seniors, you ready? It's like the best news of your life so far. Except one thing, we'll get to that. Vacation, we like to share that good news with other people. We send beautiful pictures on our Instagrams, make everyone else jealous of how awesome that is. We share the good news of starting to work out, right? You know, this is a big step. I'm starting to work out. I'm getting fit. This is good. Maybe something like the surgery was successful. It's good news. I'm healed. I'm going to be okay. We share that good news with anyone who will listen. Maybe it's having a baby, right? We share that good news. P.S. Did you guys know that we're having a baby girl in June? We're just a month away. I know. I just wanted to share that with you. It's good news. We love sharing good news. We go all out, don't we? We take pictures. We write multiple paragraph posts on Facebook and Instagram. It's in almost all of our conversation. When something good happens, we share it with anyone and everyone who will listen. Okay, so newsflash. Are you ready for it? If you're a follower of Jesus Christ, if you have turned from your sin and embraced Jesus by faith for forgiveness of your sin, and you have made him Lord and Savior over your life, you have the best news of all. Amen. Best news. Better than all of the things that I just listed, better than anything that you can think of. That is the best news. Amen. Amen. You have Christ, and he has you. Your life is changed, altered, not only now, but forever. Your eternity has been altered, and you will spend forever with Jesus Christ. That's awesome news, isn't it? Okay, so if that's true of all of us in this room, if we all have this good news, if we all have this great news, this best news, then why aren't we shouting this from the rooftops every chance we get? Well, we're going to talk about that today. Because today we're going to be going and seeing in Scripture one of my favorite subjects, and that is witnessing and evangelism. We're going to be in Colossians chapter 4. We're going to be in verses 2 through 6. We're continuing on in our series, Satisfied, Christ for Empty Hearts. And today we are talking about witnessing, about evangelism. And did you notice as we've been going through this, the past two chapters, there's been a structure that's forming here about when a person becomes a follower of Jesus Christ. There's a structure that's building, and we're seeing it in the last two chapters of Colossians. There are things that need to happen, and note the order of how these things happen in the Scripture. In Colossians 3, first, it starts with you. It starts with you. It starts with setting my mind and setting my heart upon the Lord Jesus Christ. It starts with me putting off sin and putting on Christ-likeness. It starts with all of that. Then, second, it takes it to the family, takes it to the household. So this is how I need to change and be transformed inwardly, but then this is how I need to go and take the power of Christ to my house, to my family, to those in close relationship with me. And then finally, what we're going to see here today is that we need to take it to the world. We need to take it to the world. I love how this scripture gives a full picture of how a Christian should be, how we're supposed to act inwardly in relationship and family, how we're to interact with the world, and we're going to see how to take this good news of Jesus Christ to the world with wisdom, which brings us to the title of our message, which is Wisdom as You Witness. Wisdom as You Witness. We're in Colossians chapter 4, verse 2. Let's read this together. We're going to go from 2 to verse 6. It says this, "Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray also for us that God may open to us a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. Walk in wisdom towards outsiders, making the best use of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer each person." So in our wisdom, as we witness, the first thing that we're gonna see in the text here is that we need to be praying intentionally. Pray intentionally. Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. This is the first thing that we need to do. Before we can take it to others, before we can take it to the world, we need to be a people of prayer. We need to be intentional with our prayer. Wisdom and witness starts with intentional prayer. And Paul helps us with this. He gives us the how to pray, and then he gives us the what to pray. We see it so clearly in Scripture, don't we? Right there in verse 2. How do we pray? How do we pray intentionally? Like this. Continue steadfastly in prayer. The first thing is steadfast in prayer. This means to persist in, to be devoted to be engaged in. We should be persisting in prayer, devoted to prayer, engaged in prayer, unmovable in prayer. You know, when you drove into church this morning, you came onto the campus and you parked in the parking lot and you drove past some pretty gigantic trees. Did anyone see those? They're like these huge oak trees, or maybe they're maple. I'm not like a tree guy, but they're huge. They're massive. They have clearly been there for a very long time. And I love looking at those trees. And every time I drive into church, being reminded and looking at those trees as a symbol of steadfastness. They're unmovable. They're persisting. They're continual. They have been there for a long, long time to grow to the size that they are. And we need to be like those trees in prayer. Roots so far down and so strong in prayer that no storm, no wind, no trouble can knock it over. Nothing is going to get us off of prayer. We need to be steadfast in prayer. Paul goes on, he says, not only being steadfast in prayer, but being watchful in it. Being watchful in it. This is a constant readiness. It's being on alert. It's being undistracted. Now, I'm a dad. Parents, you probably know where I'm going with this, right? I've had to learn to be watchful. Anytime we take our eyes off of the little ones, what happens, right? You know, they start getting into something they're not supposed to, right? They start climbing on something they shouldn't. They start putting things in their mouth that they shouldn't. They start putting things in their ears that they shouldn't, right? Like, dude, that's not where Legos go. They don't go there. They go on the table. We have to be watchful. We need to be that way in our prayer, ready, alert, undistracted, because the truth is that so many things in life are trying to distract us, to pull our attention away from praying intentionally for witnessing to others. I know that that's true a lot of times in my life, so we need to be watchful in prayer. And then Paul says this, thanksgiving, to be watchful in thanksgiving. Watchful in it with thanksgiving. I think that this might be one of Paul's favorite words. Have you noticed that as we've been going through the later part of Colossians? That word, or a variation of that word, thankfulness, thanksgiving, it's been coming up a lot, right? It's actually come up 4 times in the past 12 verses. I think he's trying to tell us something. We have a lot to be thankful for, don't we? We have so much. As a Christian, we have so much to be thankful for. Thank you, Lord, for hearing my prayers. Thank you, Lord, that you are a God who listens to my prayers. How awesome is that? I'm so thankful for that. Thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you, Lord, for giving me the gift of life. Thank you, Lord, for allowing me to be used by you, to be your mouthpiece, to have opportunity. We have so much to be thankful for in the Christian life. So that's how we pray. Continue in steadfastness, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. That's how we pray. And now is the what to pray. Now is the what to pray. Paul goes on, he says, at the same time, pray also for us, that God may open to us a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison. At the same time, pray also for us. Awesome. All right, got it. What does Paul need prayer for? Maybe for their family, maybe for a raise at work, maybe for some healing in relationships, maybe for safety, maybe for food. No, that's not it. That's not it at all. Now, those things are great to pray for. But you should pray for those things. Those are really great things to pray for. But this shows what's on Paul's heart, doesn't it? It shows exactly where Paul's heart is. What's his top need? What's his main focus? What's his number one priority? It's this, that God may open a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I am in prison. This is what Paul chooses to ask for prayer for. Out of all of the things that Paul could have asked for prayer for, this is the thing that he chooses to ask for, that God would open a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ. Like, if that was me, I'd be praying that God would just like open up the door to the jail cell so I could be free, right? That's what I would be praying, but Paul doesn't do that. Because remember, where is Paul? He's in prison, right? He's in prison. And why is he in prison? For sharing the gospel. It's kind of ironic, isn't it? Paul is asking for prayer for the very thing that put him into prison. That God would open a door for the word to continue sharing the mystery of Christ or the gospel of Jesus Christ, no matter the personal cost to him. And the truth is that God really didn't need to open the door of his cell. God didn't need to open that physical door because Paul would just convert the guards that were watching him. They would send in new guards to watch over Paul as he was in prison, and he would send them back saved. He kept doing that over and over and over. Guards would come in, and then they would go out, and they would know Jesus Christ. God was opening, truly answered this prayer of opening a door for the word so that Paul could declare the mystery of Christ, the gospel of Christ, even though he was in jail. Man, what if we prayed like that? What if we prayed like Paul? I have to confess, I struggle with this. Maybe you do as well. Taking the time to intentionally pray, to specifically pray that God would open a door for the word so that we can proclaim the gospel. Intentional prayer. My prayers usually are sporadic. Maybe yours are too. It's just kind of, I have to really work on this really hard to pray intentionally. I brought some wonderful Legos. Now notice, we have big Legos because we tried the small Legos and someone did try to put them in his ear. And so we got the big ones, can't fit in there, all right? These are good. But a lot of the times, my prayer looks like this. I just grab a couple of things that's happening in my life. I'm like, okay, what's happening today? 1, 2, 3, all of these things. And I'm like, all right, Lord, there we go. That's my prayer. I just kind of throw it out there. Just whatever's on my mind, it's sporadic, it's messy, it's not really organized, it's not intentional, it's not specific. It's kind of all over the place. Wherever my mind is, wherever I am at that moment, that's exactly how I pray. But Paul is saying that we need to pray intentionally. We need to take these pieces and we need to start being intentional with them. We need to start interlocking them and building something here. Something, this doesn't look too beautiful, but it definitely has shape and structure. In our house, this is a spaceship, okay? We can't have sporadic prayer. We need to be intentional with our prayers. Asking God to open a door so that we can witness, so that we can evangelize, so that we can proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because when we pray intentionally, God is so faithful to answer, isn't he? Have you ever had seasons like this as you're witnessing and as you're evangelizing? When you pray specifically for God to open a door, he's faithful to do it, isn't he? He brings people. He brings them into your life so that you can share the gospel with them. God, open the door for me to witness to my coworker. God, open the door for me to witness to my family member. God, open the door for me to witness to the person at my gym, at the grocery store, walking down the street, in my local Starbucks. When we pray like that, God is faithful to open the door. But when we fail to pray intentionally like that, we miss opportunity. We miss opportunities. And so we need to ask ourselves some questions in regards to witness. Some pretty important questions. First thing is, am I praying? Am I praying for it? Am I actually taking the time, sitting down, and praying for witness, for opportunity? The second question is, how am I praying for it? How am I praying for it? Am I doing it steadfastly? Am I doing it by being watchful with thanksgiving? Or is this a prayer that I shoot up to the Lord every, you know, once every blue moon, once every month, once every year? God's word tells us that we need to be continual, that we need to be steadfast, engaged in it, devoted to praying for this. And then what am I praying? What am I praying? Am I praying that God would open a door Am I praying that God would open a door for me to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ to whomever I meet? Maybe it's in a specific area of my life. What am I praying? First thing we need to do is pray intentionally. Pray intentionally. Here's the second thing that we see. Communicate clearly. So when God opens the door for the word, then we need to communicate clearly. When God opens the door, we need to open our mouths. When God opens the door, we need to open our mouths. Look at verse 4. Verse 4 says, that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. He's talking about the gospel. That I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. Well, Paul, this verse is pretty clear. So good job so far. This isn't complicated. This isn't complicated at all. We need to communicate clearly the gospel of Jesus Christ. Paul's desire, his prayer, is that he may be able to make it clear, to proclaim it openly, fully, boldly, and clearly, which is how I ought to speak. Paul says in Ephesians 6, 19 through 20, he says that words may be given to me in opening my mouth boldly to proclaim the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that I may declare it boldly as I ought to speak. Listen, communicating the gospel is so important. Communicating it clearly is so important. It's all too easy to present less than the gospel, isn't it? To present a watered-down gospel. To present an ear-tickling gospel. Something that people can easily swallow. And what happens is when we get the opportunity to share the gospel with someone, fear tries to seep in, doesn't it? It tries to seep in. Well, if I say it that way, they for sure won't like that. If I go up to this person and I tell them that they're a sinner, that's not gonna go over well. If I talk about the resurrection, that Jesus Christ rose from the dead, they're gonna think I'm crazy. And so we start to, everyone do some air quotes with me right here. We start to help, okay? We start to help the gospel be better heard by people. Can I just tell you something right now? The gospel doesn't need your help, okay? The gospel doesn't need your help. It does not need your editing. It does not need your altering. It does not need your opinion. The gospel of Jesus Christ stands perfectly on its own. Amen? And the prayer request from Paul here isn't to make the gospel better received by the people. It's to communicate it clearly, fully, boldly. We need to be vigilant in this, to be communicating the gospel clearly. We need to show Jesus Christ clearly to the people that we encounter. That's pretty clear right there, isn't it? We can all see that. We need people to have a clear view of who Jesus is. Clarity. But so much of the time what we do is we think that they're going to be offended by the words that we say, and we start editing and altering, and all of a sudden we're putting a filter over it. And what happens? Becomes a little fuzzy, becomes a little out of focus, becomes unclear what that's exactly saying. You can kind of see it, but you kind of can't really. And we make it so that people have an unclear view of who Jesus actually is. We can't do that. We can't obstruct the view of Jesus Christ. We can't. We must and we need and we want to have absolute clarity when seeing Jesus Christ. Or the people that we're sharing the gospel with won't know who and what they are responding to. So I wrote down some pitfalls that we fall into when presenting the gospel. I chose some funny names for them. Hope you're okay with that. The first one is the storytime gospel. It's the storytime gospel, right? This is when we share our testimony, and we ask people to respond based on our testimony, okay? Now, can I just say something really fast? You should absolutely share your testimony, okay? Don't get that from what I'm saying right now. 100%, 10 out of 10, you should do it. Share your testimony. In fact, I wanna show you how to do that. We teach this a lot in our small groups. Here's how you share your testimony. Simple little phrase. I was, but God, and now. I was, fill in that statement, what were you? I was a sinner. I was struggling. I was broken. But God opened my eyes. He opened my heart. He showed me his word. He spoke to me. He changed my life. And now I'm living for him. I'm living for Jesus, and he is bringing to me his word and understanding of who he is and how to live the Christian life. That's different for everyone. I was, but God, and now. We should absolutely be sharing our testimony, but it can't just stop there. It can't just stop with the story. We have to be bringing them the word of God as well. We have to be bringing them scripture. It's not just our testimony, it's our testimony with scripture, with God's word. And so if you can put scripture in your testimony, you're crushing it. You can put it inside of your testimony, you can bring scripture at the end of your testimony. We need to bring God's word to our testimonies, because what are they responding to? Are they responding to your words, or are they responding to God's word? That's the story time gospel. Then we get this one. We see this a lot, the vending machine gospel, right? Mm-hmm. I put my quarter in, I punch in the button, and out pops what I want, right? Listen, do you want a life that is so much better? Do you want a life that is gonna, you'll have no problems, okay? Let me tell you, rainbows, unicorns, butterflies, that's the Christian life. You just gotta put in the quarter, press the dial, and boom, God sends it. He brings it to you. Now, the truth is that Jesus Christ brings us a lot of great things, doesn't he? He does. But he's not a vending machine. And when we give people that type of gospel, that Jesus Christ is a vending machine, then they go and they put their quarter in, they punch in the number, and they're like, "What? I don't understand. What's happening? That person told me that I would get exactly what I wanted." It's not the gospel. Here's another one. The scoreboard gospel. The scoreboard gospel. I am trying to get a commitment out of you as fast as possible, all right? I'm trying to get a commitment as fast as possible. Listen, it doesn't matter if you understand everything I'm saying, okay? Okay, I know that we've only been talking for 30 seconds, but it's time to make a decision, okay? Will you commit? And they're like, to what? And you're like, to this. And they're like, okay. And you're like, scoreboard, one, got them, soul. It's the scoreboard gospel. I'm trying to get as many as fast as I can. And I'm not giving the opportunity to have those long conversations, to really give a clear view of who Jesus is. This is Jesus. It takes longer than a 30-second conversation. Can I just tell you that? It does. Talking about Jesus, bringing clarity of who Jesus is and the story of Christ. That's the scoreboard gospel. And then finally this, diet gospel, right? Diet gospel. I'm gonna pick out all of the hard to swallow facts of the gospel to present you with something that you won't have a problem drinking, okay? Zero calories, right? It's the diet gospel. I'm picking and choosing things to take out so that it'll become more palatable for you, so that it's easier to swallow, so that it tickles a little bit more, so it's easy to go down. Those are pitfalls we fall into when presenting the gospel. I want you to just write down these five words. And I would put them in the front of my Bible so that when you're walking with your Bible and you have the opportunity to share Jesus Christ with someone, you will have these five words in the front of your Bible forever, okay? These are five words. This is how we can clearly and simply share the gospel of Jesus Christ. It can happen in five words. I love this method. It's my personal favorite because it's five words. I can remember five words, okay? I can do that. Here are the five words. Here's the first one. It starts with God. Pretty simple, right? It starts with God. Where does the Bible start? It starts with God. Genesis 1, right? God is creating everything. He has created the universe and everything in it. Deuteronomy 4:35 says that there is no other God but him. There's no other God but him. And he has created everything, the universe and everything in it. He created us. He created mankind. Bless you. He created mankind. And when he did, he said, it was very good. And mankind had a perfect relationship with God. Perfect. Perfect relationship. It was amazing. But then something happened. Mankind, which we a lot of times do, we're silly, we're stupid, right? And they disobeyed God. God said, don't eat from that tree. Don't do it. Don't eat the fruit of that tree. And they what? They went and did it. They were tempted and they went and ate and they disobeyed God, which allowed sin to enter into the world. And sin was a big problem because everyone has it. Romans 3:23 tells us that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All. So if you're sitting in here and you're like, I've never sinned in my life. Wrong. Yes, you have. Everyone has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Every single person has this problem of sin. And sin, the consequence of it, Romans 6:23. So we've got Romans 3:23 and 6:23. Easy to remember, right? The wages of sin is death. The wages of sin, the consequence of sin is death. Not only physical death, but spiritual as well. Separation from God for eternity. That's a big problem, isn't it? And it needs a solution. And so God, in his great love for you and me and for mankind, sent Jesus Christ, his son, fully God, fully man, to this earth to live a perfect life, a life that we could never live, and to die the death that we deserved to die. That's the third word, substitution. So we have God, we have sin, substitution. Jesus Christ died in my place, taking the full weight of sin on his shoulders. He is my substitute. Jesus in my place. He died that death that I deserved to die. He's my substitute. And then he was raised again 3 days later and ascended into heaven, defeating sin and death. And what he asks is that we would believe in him. That's the fourth word, believe. John 5:24 says, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. Believe. Believe all of those things about Jesus, that he is who he says he is, fully God, fully man, perfect life, death, resurrection, ascension into heaven, that he is Lord and Savior over our life, that I am a sinner and I need Jesus Christ as a Savior. Believe. And then this, fifth, life. Life. John 10:10 says that I came so that you may have life, and that you may have it abundantly. So it is not only just a changed life, a transformed life now here on earth, but it's also eternal life, John 3:16, right? Whoever shall believe in me will have eternal life. Changed life now, eternal life forever. Five simple words: God, sin, substitution, believe, and life. We can bring that to people with clarity. That's the gospel. That's the gospel of Jesus Christ. So we have pray intentionally, we have communicate clearly, and then third, this, live wisely. Live wisely. Look at verse 5. It says, walk in wisdom towards outsiders, making the best use of the time. So we're communicating, we're talking, we're speaking, but we also need to walk. We need to talk, and we need to walk. Because the most important thing that you say usually isn't with words, right? It's with who you are. It's with how you act. Because that's what brings credibility to the words that I say. That's the way that I act, my attitude, and then the words that I say. Walk in wisdom, the scripture is telling us, that Paul is urging us to do. Walk in wisdom towards outsiders. Walking in wisdom is evaluating circumstance and making godly choices. Evaluating circumstance and making godly choices. This is referencing our character. This is referencing our reputation. Is the way that I'm acting, am I acting in a manner worthy of the Lord? Is my attitude situated in a manner worthy of the Lord? Are my words being used in a manner worthy of the Lord toward outsiders? And outsiders are just people who don't know the Lord. So people who don't know the Lord. This letter is being written to the church. Outsiders are people that don't know the Lord. So if my actions, my attitude, and my words don't reflect clearly that I'm living for Jesus Christ, that ruins our witness. It ruins our witness to people. Does my neighbor see me as being unloving to my family? Do my coworkers hear me speaking rudely or crudely in the office? Is my attitude terrible towards the people that I come in contact with during my day? What do people see when they observe my life? What do people see when they observe the manner of my life? Is it those things? Or is it actions, attitudes, and words that reflect an authentic faith in Christ? Because when they do, when I get that right and people see it, I can reinforce, my life reinforces the power of Christ, the power of faith, the power of grace, the power of the gospel by the way that I live. Another way to say it is I don't only need to speak the gospel with clarity, I need to live the gospel with clarity. I don't only need to speak the gospel with clarity, I need to live the gospel with clarity as well. Paul goes on, he says, to making the best use of the time. So walking in wisdom towards outsiders and making the best use of the time. We can find a lot of use for our time, can't we? Like there is no shortage of Netflix shows that we can binge on, right? There's no shortage. No shortage of stores to go to, no shortage of work around the house, but we are called to make the best use of the time. That means we need to take full advantage of every opportunity to show the reality of our faith. To take advantage of every opportunity for evangelism, for witness, for sharing the gospel. Because the truth is, we are not promised tomorrow. You are not promised tomorrow. I am not promised tomorrow. Life is fleeting. It's like a mist. It's like a vapor. Here today and gone tomorrow. Our days are numbered and ordained by God. And we don't know how many we have left. I have today, God willing, the rest of the day, but I don't know. And the truth is that we don't know how many the people who we pass on the street or come in contact with every single day, we don't know how many days they have left either. We don't. So don't let opportunity pass you by. Take advantage. Make the best use of the time. Take advantage. Don't miss the opportunity to share the gospel with other people. Now, newsflash, I was a nerd growing up, okay? I'm not ashamed to say it, I was, all right? I was. I liked a lot of things that were very uncool, okay? I liked Pokemon cards, which became cool. I liked video games before they were cool. I was a nerd in high school. And during all of that, there was this really nerdy thing that was coming through the internet. And it was a new thing that people were trading online, and they were like, listen, this is the newest thing. You want to get on it, I'm telling you. You can trade, like, you can buy stuff. It was called Bitcoin, and it was going through its early stages. And I knew about it, and I was like, guys, I don't know if this is going to work. I don't know. It seems like something that's not really going to work. I'm not going to really waste my money on it. Now, here's the truth that when I found out about Bitcoin, it was going for 6 cents for every Bitcoin, okay? So if I were to have, in 2010, like in July 2010, if I would have bought $100 worth of Bitcoin in 2010 for 6 cents, today, I just looked it up last night. I do this every once in a while. I looked it up last night, and it would be worth today. Are you ready for this? Are you ready? $12,959,983. I really messed that one up. Everyone say, great job, Tommy. Great, I know. I missed that opportunity. The truth is, though, is that all of that money would eventually have been burned away anyway, right? I can't take it with me to heaven. But I can maximize and take advantage of every spiritual opportunity that I have on earth to share the gospel, because that is eternal. This isn't going to fade away. It's not going to be destroyed. This is going to last forever. I want to talk about a good investment. Witnessing, evangelizing, sharing the gospel, that is a good investment. That is worthy of our time. That is a good use, the best use of our time. So how can I walk in wisdom to outsiders? How can I do all of this that Paul is asking us to do right here, to live wisely? How can I walk in wisdom? Well, I just wrote down four things that I found in Scripture. The first is to fear for it. A Proverbs 9:10 Fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Fear the Lord. If you want wisdom, you need to fear the Lord. Fearing God is the beginning of wisdom. The second thing is to ask for it. This is found in James chapter 1, verse 5. If any of you need wisdom, ask. Ask. Ask for it, and God will give it to you generously, graciously, without reproach. If you need wisdom, ask for it. Pray. God, I need wisdom. How should I approach this situation? How should I do this? Ask for it. Number three is listen for it. And we find this right in Colossians 1, verse 28. It says, him we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom that we may present everyone mature in Christ. This is teaching. This is listening for it. This is listening for teaching in wisdom. Listen for it. And then finally, we also find this one in Colossians chapter 2, verse 2. Read for it. Read for it. Verse 2 says, that their hearts may be encouraged, being knit together in love to reach all the riches of full assurance of understanding and the knowledge of God's mystery, which is Christ. And then we learned not too long ago that in chapter 3, right at the end, that we need to let the word of Christ dwell in us richly. This is reading it. We find wisdom in reading and studying God's word. Fear for it, ask for it, listen for it, and read for it. And then finally, this. Speak graciously. Speak graciously. So we have praying intentionally, communicating clearly, living wisely, and then speak graciously. Verse 6 says, let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. We talk a lot. Amen? We talk a lot. Whether it's in person or over the phone or through text message or on the internet, we talk a lot. Now, this is really convicting for me and maybe for you as well. How much of that talk should be gracious? God's word says all of it. Let your speech always be gracious. Always. Here's why that's important. It's because people are listening. People are listening. They're listening to me. They're listening to you. Is the way that I'm speaking reflecting my relationship with Jesus Christ? So in our presentation of the gospel, we need to speak with grace. We need our speech to be filled with graciousness as we present the gospel. We cannot be brash or harsh. Listen, the gospel is offensive enough on its own, all right? It's offensive enough on its own. We do not need to be more offensive with our delivery of the gospel to people. Our speech needs to be gracious. And then Paul says, seasoned with salt. Seasoned with salt. Salt is delicious, isn't it? It's delicious. It makes things flavorful. You guys see those videos, maybe on like Facebook or something, that guy who like has like a giant delicious piece of meat and he does like this thing and like just pours like a gigantic amount of salt. Anyone see that? I forgot his name. Anyway, he does that. He's like, just launches salt onto this meat and I'm like, that looks awesome. Like I wanna eat it right. I'm salivating right now just thinking about it. Salt brings flavor. It brings delicious flavor to things. That's how our speech should be, seasoned with salt. It should be flavorful and desirable, flavoring our speech with the Lord. Also, what else does salt do? It keeps things pure, doesn't it? It keeps things from rotting and decaying. It keeps it pure. Our speech needs to be pure against corruption, encouraging others to follow suit in our conversations. Needs to be gracious and seasoned with salt. And then finally this, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. Now, as a pastor, this is the biggest hurdle that I hear about when people are talking about evangelism. Pastor Tommy, you know, what if they ask a question that I don't know the answer to? What if they ask that question and that scares them away from ever evangelizing again? They're like, that one question, I don't even know what that question is, but if they ask it, I'm done for. I would be lying if I said that I didn't worry about that sometimes too. Like, what if I get like an incredibly seasoned atheist and he stumps me with a crazy philosophical question? That's an honest thought that I frequently have. Now, I will say that I have yet to meet that person. I'm sure they exist. I have not met them yet. And even if I did meet that person, I would still share the gospel. And I would search God's word for the answer to their question. I would still share the gospel. That's how we should respond to people who ask us questions. We should respond honestly. It's okay to be honest with people. Don't try and just make up an answer. If you don't know the answer to their question, if you don't got it, don't just try to make it up. You'll get yourself in a lot of hot water, okay? I've made that mistake and now I'm giving that to you. Don't do that. Don't make up an answer. It's okay to be honest. Say it honestly. Hey, listen, I don't actually know the answer to that question. That's a really good question. But let's take a look at God's word together. Can we? Can we just open God's word together and just take a look and see what God's word has to say about that? Can we find the answer together in God's word? It's okay to not have all of the answers. Let me encourage you in that. Did you hear me? It's okay to not have all of the answers. Because the truth is that we have this book, and in this book are all of the answers. And we can find the answers right here. Everything relating to the Lord, everything relating to God, we can find. He's given this to us. We can open it anytime and find it. Don't ever let this stop you from evangelizing. I don't know. What if they ask? I won't know it. Don't let that ever stop you from sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because if we pray intentionally, if we communicate clearly, if we live wisely, if we speak graciously, then we're going to have an open door from the Lord. We're going to have an open mouth speaking the gospel, and we're going to be speaking it to an open heart. So maybe you're wondering some practical things. What are some easy ways to share the gospel? Like, when are some places in life? How do I know if someone's ready for the gospel? We actually collaborated and talked about this as pastors. What are some moments in life that are where we can share the gospel with someone? We kind of put down two categories. The first one is life change. When there's a life change in someone's life, when something dramatically happens, the birth of a child. Parents, you know, how ill-equipped did you feel when you had your kid? You're like, I thought I had it all together. I do not. The birth of a child, moving to another city, to another country, starting a new job. These are great areas for us to be sharing the gospel with people as they step into something new, as their lives are changing. Starting a new year, starting a marriage. That makes you start thinking about a lot of things when you start in marriage, doesn't it? What are we gonna do together? What are we gonna do with our kids? How are we gonna raise our kids? What's that gonna look like as a family? Well, let me share the gospel with you. Let me tell you what Jesus Christ has to say about all of that. So not only life change, but another opportunity that we have with people to share the gospel is in their pain and in their struggle. The end of a marriage, the death of a loved one, the failure of a business, the loss of a home, the loss of a job, dealing with major illness. In those moments, we can bring to them Jesus Christ. And while Jesus Christ may not fix those things, remember, he's not a vending machine. Guess what he does do? He brings hope, and he brings comfort, and he brings healing. These are great open doors to declare the mystery of Christ, the gospel of Jesus Christ. You know, we've been talking a lot about witness and evangelism amongst our Elgin team, and we're really excited to jump into this as a church. We're really excited. We want to have this summer be focused on evangelism, focused on going out and witnessing. And so we want to give you some really practical ways to go out and do that. One of those you're going to get on your way out, and it's this bookmark right here. I think we've got a graphic for it that's going to come up. It's this bookmark right here. And it's got the points that we talked about today. It's got the scripture that we went through today, wisdom as we witness. And then on the back side of it, we've got a place for five names. And this is an opportunity for us to pray for open doors, for open mouths, and for open hearts to share the gospel of Jesus Christ with the people in our life. And I would just love for you to write down names or areas where you want the Lord to open the door for you to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. What are some areas? Who are some people that you can share the gospel with? Who are some people that you can start praying for right now? Lord, give me opportunity. Lord, open the door. Open the door so that I can share the word of God, so I can share the gospel of Jesus Christ with this person in this place. Start praying intentionally for that, for the opportunity to communicate clearly. This is for you. It's going to be for you on your way out. Make sure that you grab that. It's a good bookmark too. It's nice and big. You know, I like big bookmarks. You can see it wherever, you know, wherever you need. We also, over the summer, we're going to be having classes for witnessing, uncommon witness. It's a great opportunity. If you're wanting to even know more, what are some good strategies? What are some ways that I can really effectively bring the gospel of Jesus Christ? We have classes called Uncommon Witness that are going to be available for you to come and to learn evangelism and to learn witness and how to do that effectively in different areas of your life. It's really a great thing. We'd love for you to join us in that. And then also, maybe you've heard this, I think, from our elders and from our church leadership team, is the Closer campaign. There's been money that is specifically sectioned off for outreach into our community to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ to our city. How awesome is that? What a provision from the Lord that we get to go out and to take this and resource people going into our community and evangelizing. And listen, I have faith to believe that our focus on witness and evangelism in our personal lives and as a church, that in a couple of weeks, in a couple of months, we are going to hear stories from that baptismal right there of people coming to know Jesus Christ and Him changing their lives forever, changing their eternities. I have faith to believe that. Do you have faith to believe that? That the Lord is going to use you in a powerful way as you pray intentionally that God would open the door for you to go out into the community, into your neighborhood, into your household, to bring the word of the Lord, to proclaim the mystery of Christ, to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, to do it clearly. That the Lord would help us to live wisely and speak graciously with those who we come into contact with, working together as a local expression of the church body, working together for God's glory. Amen. Amen. Let me pray for us this morning. God, we are so thankful for you. We're so thankful for your word. You make it so clear to us. Thank you for the clarity of your word. Lord, would you help us in this? I just pray against any fear that is gripping hearts as we think about witnessing, as we think about evangelism. Lord, would you steady our hearts? Would you bring courage to our hearts? Lord, would you focus our hearts on praying? Praying intentionally for doors to be open in our lives. Lord, would you give us the wisdom to communicate clearly and live wisely and speak graciously to others? Lord, we need your help with this. We cannot do this on our own. Help us, Lord. Destroy fear in our lives. Give us courage to boldly proclaim, not holding anything back. Lord, we are not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. No, we are not. We are ambassadors of you. Lord, send us. Use us. Help us, Lord, we pray right now to do this, to witness, to tell the good news, to shout it from the rooftops. You have been so good to us, Lord, and we want to share this news with other people. Help us. Help us do that, we pray. All of this in the strong and powerful name of Jesus Christ. Amen.